Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back for the next part of our Congress. Olmody, everybody's in? We have three speakers after this short coffee break. Till lunch break we have the three speakers. First we have Niels Rosmuller. Niels, he is a professor in transportation safety, and I know Niels for a very long time because he's helping me out in my role as a chairman from the National Committee for Risk Management and Fire Prevention. He is doing a lot of studies about tunnels, infrastructure, whatever. And nowadays, he is becoming more and more interested in the energy transition. So he's going to tell us something about that. His presentation is called Green Vehicles, Red Flags, and it's about all kind of vehicles using other fuels than our traditional ones. So Niels, the floor is yours for the next 45 minutes. Thank you. I know Niels a long time, I said. So.
Let's see, everything is working. So before the coffee break, we talked about Lard Eddy simulation, Navier-Stokes, the Froude number, so now we're going in depth. No, my title of the speech is Green Vehicles and Red Flags. And why did I choose this title? It's because we are more and more dealing with the transition in energy, sustainability, and that is in particular also relevant in the transportation domain. What we see is that alternative fueled vehicles are more and more getting into use in our society. We use those cars ourselves. We have to go to fuel stations. We have to go to car parks. We have charging stations. So it's not only the cars that are dealing with those sustainability aspects, but it's the whole infrastructure around this, let's say, sustainable fuel energy transition. That's the first two words of the title. The seconds are red flags. Why this red flags? The funny thing is, science is about knowing things, but for now, this energy transition is moving fastward in an, let's say, dazzling speed. And more we as firefighters, US firefighters, are dealing with those innovations in the energy transition. And we don't know every single detail of it, and we don't know either how to deal with fires and incidents with, for example, hydrogen vehicles or electric vehicles or large fires with a mix of those kind of vehicles in car parks. So that's why I chose for this title, Green Vehicles, Red Flags, and I hope to make you curious about the safety aspects that are involved with the energy transition that is speeding up in our society. For the main line of my 35 minutes presentation, I have made four blocks. First, some slides about the energy transition and the safety aspects that are involved with that. Then a part that deals with the green vehicles and the infrastructure beyond. The red flags, I pose some safety issues. And some of the colleagues before ended their presentations with additional research required. I think regarding the energy transition, there is really a lot of additional research required to understand the safety mechanisms and how to deal with incidents involving LNG, hydrogen, electric vehicle, biomass, geothermics, and so on. And finally, I come with some concluding remarks. So let's start by the energy transition. And I more or less scoped it within the Netherlands because that is what I know from the energy transition. And in international research, we are trying to, let's say, what is going on in the countries like Germany, the UK, in the Scandinavian countries, what they are doing with the energy transition and safety. But for us in the Netherlands, some headlines. We made this climate agreement, and we are dealing with the carbon dioxide reduction, about 50%, let's say, to be precise, 49% in 2030, to reduce the carbon dioxide. And one of the main programs to deal with this reduction is to get rid of the fossil fuels in our energy consumption. And that doesn't mean that from tomorrow on we don't need fossil fuels anymore, but there will be a mixture of fuels and energy types in our society for 10, 20, 30 years on. So when I talk about alternative fuels, don't forget that we still have to deal with the fossil fuels that we have already in our society right now. So what we see with this energy transition in the transportation domain, and we made it, let's say, an issue of our government, that we more and more are transforming to green vehicles, whether it is trucks on LNG, whether it's ships on LNG, personal cars using hydrogen as a fuel, or even biomass fuels and solar energy. There are all kind of vehicles using sustainable, reusable energy sources. And for to coordinate these innovative activities, in the Dutch we have this, let's say, this group of experts who made the policy, the Dutch national policy. It's called the Top Sector Energy, and they created this landscape about the energy transition regarding sustainable energies. It is in Dutch, but I will briefly touch upon liquefied natural gas, biomass, all meant to reduce the carbon dioxide release, and also the green gas like biomass, biogas, and geothermics, solar energy, wind energy, all kind of, let's say, sustainable sources that we promote to get rid of those fossil fuels in the future. This is a small picture from a paper, I think it's a couple of months ago, which in brief says we're going to create 100 hydrogen fuel stations to make sure that people who buy a hydrogen fueled car are really able to fuel their car in the Netherlands. However, what was the headline in one of the Dutch papers yesterday? It says hydrogen is not a big issue anymore at our climate tables. So the funny thing here is that when you like to get a big movement in a country, you have to be, let's say, sure that this is also a long time perspective. So we saw, for example, with the LNG activities in the Netherlands, they got tax advantages to introduce LNG. And now these tax advantages to truck operators are not anymore active. So what does that do with the truck companies? They think, are we still willing to invest in LNG, or do we wait for another kind of national policy and see what's going on there? And these kind of, let's say, varieties in policy directions make it difficult both for the industry but also for firefighters. What will the future bring us regarding sustainable energy and their safety aspects? I touch upon six let's say, sustainable sources, energy carriers. I do that very briefly, and most of the time I will use a, let's say, a video about the safety aspects. Wind energy, biomass, geothermics, solar energy, battery packs, and hydrogen. And I will emphasize more in my presentation on the safety aspects of hydrogen. So let's see. We have wind energy. It's not meant to understand how a wind turbine works. But the funny thing about wind energy is, you might think, what can go wrong with wind energy? It's clean, you have wind, and what are the safety issues or dilemmas involved with wind energy? I can speak upon it, but I will show you two videos that that show you the risks involved in those kind of wind turbines. After the video, I will briefly point out what the meaning of the video was and why I think it's interesting for us to get a good clue on what wind energy does and how we could be encounter wind energy and safety aspects in our practice. So it's turning quite. So there it is. Was. The thing with this wind turbine is that we position them along our highways, our bridges, near tunnels, even on Seviso installations. And we are not really aware about several risks of these wind turbines. Normally, they have a brake on their system, so this way of turning, would be prevented if this brake would work, but that wasn't the case. And when you imagine that such a wind turbine is close to a bridge or a Seviso installation, you can imagine that the consequences could be more serious than in this way when it breaks down and lands in the field. Oh, sorry. This is another one. The consequences are more serious here. There were two fatalities involved in this wind turbine fire.
Op 29 oktober 2013, rond 3:15, ontstond er brand in een windturbine aan de Mariadijk te Achthuizen. Twee monteurs waren op grote hoogte bezig met hun werkzaamheden. De brand werd opgeschaald naar middelbrand.
Ja.
De monteurs stonden boven op de molen, bij de wieken, en vanaf het water werd gezien dat één monteur de molen insprong het vuur in.
So this video shows that during maintenance works, the wind turbine got into fire, and the two maintenance workers they died. And you saw this firefighter vehicle with his ladder approaching the vehicle. But these wind turbines, they could be over 100 meters. And more of these wind turbines appear in our fields, in the sea, and as guys and ladies from the emergency response, we face those kind of incidents, and we are really, let's say, puzzling how to deal with those risks. This one I will skip. Geothermics. Geothermics is a way to make use of the warmth into our deeper layers in the earth to make sure to use those warmth for our, let's say, our greenhouses and our, in the future, our houses to heat them up. And also with geothermics, there are some safety risks involved. Of course, some vibrations, probably you know from Groningen, where we're using gas from the earth, shakes the earth nowadays in an increasing amount. The pollution of fresh air, water layers, sometimes radioactive radiation is involved, and uncontrolled outflow of wastewater. So what you see is that, for example, the area where I live near Delft, you see more and more geothermic installations for greenhouses to use this warmth into the earth. And what we lack at this moment is how to deal with those kind of safety risks. Funny thing is, another energy transition, however, still we face them, but we are still curious how to, let's say, how to suppress the incidents involved. A third one, the solar energy. The sustainability from using solar energy is evident. However, like geothermics, like wind turbines, typical safety risk appear with solar energy. And I show you a video of a fire on a
in de nieuwe wijk
photovoltaic roof.
In Veen is donderdagmiddag brand uitgebroken op het dak van een huis. Het vuur is vermoedelijk ontstaan door kortsluiting in de zonnepanelen. Deze panelen liggen als het ware in het dak in plaats van op pannen en daarom zou de apparatuur minder makkelijk warmte kwijt kunnen. Het vuur sloeg al snel over naar een tweede woning. De brandweer stuurde flink wat wagens naar de huizen. Omdat de wijk net nieuw is, staat er volgens de veiligheidsregio minder druk op de leidingen en daarom waren extra handjes nodig.
The thing here is that the demand for solar panels is increasing and increasing in our society. Which means that more and more organizations who install those photovoltaic panels think they are able to install those panels on the roofs, which is not business as usual. You have to make sure you made the right connections, you have to make sure you use the right white equipment. And more, we know that from our colleagues in the safety regions, fire involves photovoltaic panels. And the thing that, in my words, moonlighters are installing those panels is one of the causes that more and more fires appear with these panels. Take into account that more and more houses, offices, and all kind of buildings are equipped with those panels. So I predict we get a lot of fires with solar panels the upcoming months and years. The next one, it's the Stella bicycle shop in Nunspeet. This is for the Dutch. It's Nunspeet, the Stella bicycle shop. Here in this hall, there were about 7,000 to 8,000 batteries for e-bikes stored. There are a couple of interesting things about this example. First of all, it's a big example with heavy smoke, and people are running to it to see it. Okay, all right. Second of all, the mayor of Nunspeet, he made an announcement in the media that he said we didn't know there was this large storage of batteries. And third, also the firefighters they were not aware of those large amounts of batteries stored in this hall. So when you think you go to a fire in a, let's say, a bicycle store, in fact, you go to a fire with 7,000 to 8,000 batteries who explode. Who, when they are on fire, they get a lot amount of toxic release products. So, starting with, hey, I go to a fire in a store for bicycles. You come there and you see that you have a large hole with exploding and toxic fume battery packs where you should do your suppression activities. Another one. This is in Belgium, Droge Bosch. This is not a single of not a store with 8,000 to 9,000 battery little packs, but this is a large battery pack, like a 42 container, which was stored near a factory in Drogenbos, and this one got fire, and you see those two columns of smoke. We spoke the day before yesterday with Koert Volmacher from the Belgian Firefighter Association, and he told us that at the end of the year there will be a release of a public report about this fire. The thing with this fire is that you think you have a fire near a cool tower of a factory, then it appeared to be a really large amount of batteries who are on fire, and the toxic release products from the fire, they are really disastrous for the health. What they measured is beyond, let's say, every imagination. What we measure using our own devices. So what they did there, they tried to suppress the fire, extinguish the fire. It took them 14 hours to suppress the fire, and they evacuated an area of about, I think it was 1,200 to 1,400 meters because of the toxic smoke involved in this fire. And what we see in the Netherlands, and probably in your countries as well, is that those kind of, let's say, battery containers are put at our, let's say, party areas. For example, Parkpop, they place 7 of those containers within 80,000 people listening to music. In The Hague, they saw that such a container was put near the stadium of ADO Den Haag, below the emergency exit of the visiting fans. So, yeah, it's we could laugh about it, and it's pretty funny, but the serious thing about these kind of activities is that the energy transition is speeding and dazzling up, and we see all the opportunities for the environment, for sustainability, but we are not, let's say, well aware and well equipped to really get ahead of the safety risk involved. Hydrogen, another example. Don't try to read it all, but hydrogen is very clean. Via electrolysis, we could split water into hydrogen and oxygen, so they are two harmless substances. But hydrogen has also, compared to let's say some fossil fuels, some extraordinary characteristics. It's colorless, it's odorless, it's, let's say, its density is very light, and it has a really big flammability range. And it hardly uses any, let's say, power to ignite. It has a large flammability range, and you hardly need any energy to get into flames. So hydrogen is a very, let's say the energy sector and our government is really focusing on hydrogen as the fuel of the future, but it has also some pretty serious safety aspects involved. The flames, when there is a pure combustion of hydrogen, you are not able to see the flames. However, most of the time, because of, let's say, a soil, you could see the flames. The flame ride length is for personal cars, it's about a meter of 10 meters, and it depends upon the diameter and the pressure in the tank. But when you approach car fires that are fueled and stored with hydrogen, you could encounter flames of about 5 to 10 meters. And then it's interesting to see what are the guidelines that we have within our fire companies to deal with all kinds of energy transition initiatives, whether it is solar cars, hydrogen trucks, LNG ships, or electric vehicles. And the funny thing is, we do have some generic guidelines, which of course are necessary, but all these vehicles, all these fuels, all these infrastructure beyond have their own specific lines of defense. Whether it is those pantographs at electric buses, these kind of charging stations for our own cars, LNG fuel stations, bunker stations for shipping, or even car parks, which is I think it's a very interesting presentation afterwards. What does it mean when you have all kinds of alternative fueled vehicles in those car parks? What does it mean for risk management? Do we allow all these kind of vehicles in our car parks? Are we able to define lines of defense for such, let's say, mixed vehicle car parks? And in case it goes wrong, what are the fire tactics in order to mitigate the consequences? So the key safety issue is here, the energy transition in the Netherlands, and I think in the countries beyond, is full swing. And one of the, let's say, the interesting thing is that electric, LNG, hydrogen, it's rather familiar in the industrial domain. But now it's making a shift to our public domain. And that makes it more and more important for us to think of the risks, to think of how to prepare for those risks, and even how to prevent for those risks to become reality. And the examples are rather large in the transportation domain. So what we did, for example, for the hydrogen risk, we brought together a group of people who are involved in hydrogen and safety research and practice. We talk about this community of practice hydrogen, and we gather once in 3 to 4 months, and we were quite curious how those organizations take care or arrange their suppression activities. So what we did is we studied the firefighting plans of several safety regions from the Department of de la Vie en France, the Bundeswehr, and the United States. And we compared those plans, whether we could find some red lines or white areas, how we prepare our firefighters to deal with incidents and fires with hydrogen cars. And we looked at how can we recognize those vehicles, what is mentioned in the emergency call, how do we approach those vehicles, what is recommended to stabilize the vehicle, and in the end, what are the fire tactics that are advised. And I will show you some results. First of all, those kind of vehicles, fueled hydrogen fueled vehicles, are hardly recognizable when they are on the street and when they are involved in an accident. So the first thing which is important is how are we able to recognize that we have to deal with a hydrogen car. Second, the emergency call, which is in all those guidelines is quite clear. Immediately call in a specialist on hazardous materials. The third one, how to approach such a vehicle. This was quite, let's say, various what the advices in those guidelines were. Some guidelines, they say approaches from the front, some say approaches from the side, and some say approaches from the back, or from an angle from 45 degrees. Thus, in fact, you could approach it from 360 degrees. So, and I think there should be some guideline which is more generic and make sure how to approach such a vehicle. The distance, they vary as well. Some say keep a distance of 10 meters from the back. Others say employ a safety parameter of 50 meters, so five times as high. And some say when you measure a lower explosion level of 10% or 4% hydrogen, stay away from the incident. So 10 guidelines with three or four advices. How to stabilize? Some say disconnect the 12 volts cables. Others say don't do that. Use the connection so you are still able to deal with the vehicle. So what should the fire officer do in case of a hydrogen-fueled vehicle? Should he disconnect or should he stay the connection as it is? And finally, the fire tactics. We saw some plans, no water on temperature release pressure device because of freezing, but let's say that's not an issue anymore. Those kind of safety devices are not applied in those vehicles anymore. Should we cool or should we extinguish the fire? There are some questions. There are several advices. And should we focus at the fire at the vehicle or should we focus at the fires in the environment? So 10 guidelines with, I think, about more than 10 advices for the fire officer. So then I come to some red flags, and I will briefly touch upon. What are the lines of defense? And we in our communities, we now get more and more sight on the lines of defense, the car manufacturers, the charging stations, the infrastructure managers, they apply. However, we need to look in an active way for those kind of lines of defense. We are not aware of them if we don't talk to them and if they don't talk to us. Regarding the fire suppression activities, we get more and more questions when we know about the lines of defense that the car manufacturers, the charging stations, the infrastructure managers applied. What are the safety risks of our own colleagues? What are adequate incident management strategies? And how do we know for sure that they are adequate? Because when you suppress a fire and it worked, but what makes you make the conclusion that it worked? How sure are we? And what kind of science is behind the adequately fire tactics that we applied? So what we think is that industry first should take its responsibility to involve us to make sure we know about their lines of defense, and we should visit them as well. And they can help us with their knowledge about the fire mechanisms in their vehicles, in their charging stations, in their car parks. This one I'll skip. And I will briefly go to, and that's my, let's say, my final, let's say, final ways. We, now that we are aware that we should involve the industry more and more to make them know what our concerns are, but also to hear from them what they developed for a kind of line of defense, we brought together for two subjects, industry, the safety regions, the Knowledge Institute. One is about hydrogen, and another one is about the battery packs. And the day before yesterday, I was we gathered at the community of practice regarding battery packs. We were in Eindhoven, and there we had the visit to the bus operator Hermes in this area, who operates about 40 electric fueled buses. And we got deep insights in how they took care of their safety in operating their buses. Hermes, they told us how their bus drivers were educated. We heard from the battery pack producer what kind of line of defense they took in order to prevent for a thermal runaway in their batteries. And we got deep insight from the charging stations, how the buses were charged and what kind of safety measures they all took. And this is funny because we were there with, I think, about 25 to 30 people from, I think, 20 from the safety regions. But all these kinds of safety enhancements are not known to us. And Hermes, VDL, Hexion, they are not aware of our concerns regarding electric buses on the roads, on the remises, and on the charging stations. So this is quite a fruitful way of exchanging knowledge and to make sure that we know where in-depth knowledge is available.
In Nederland rijden steeds meer elektrische auto's rond. Deze kunnen bij een oplaadpaal worden opgeladen. Maar wat moet je doen?
This is a vehicle from Firefighting Netherlands.
Met de oplaadpaal is verbonden. De collega's uit de regio Haaglanden kregen er mee te maken. Zij hebben uitgezocht welke handelingsperspectieven er zijn om de oplaadpaal en de auto los te koppelen van elkaar. In deze video laten we deze handelingsperspectieven zien. Stel je wordt gealarmeerd voor een autobrand en deze blijkt nog verbonden te zijn met een oplaadpaal. De stekker zit geborgd in de oplaadpaal en deze kun je er niet uittrekken.
Ja, this video shows exactly how to deal with this kind of incident. Electric vehicle being charged by this charging station. And of course, this video was produced after we experienced a problem with this kind of fire. And these kind of videos will appear in more and more numbers. But each time when we experience a problem, we make a video. And the funny thing is, how to get ahead of those risks before those problems appear. So, to conclude, safety issues from the energy transition in the transportation domain, they are a big issue for firefighting. And not only in suppressing the fires and the incidents, but I think the big, big step for us is to get in contact with industry so they are aware of our concerns and they can take care of safety measures in their designs. Science gives answers, but science also poses questions. And when I look at the big movement involved because of the energy transitions, we will experience a lot of safety questions in the near future. And we as firefighters are not always in control about the safety issues. And even sometimes I think we lack adequate ways of how to deal with those issues in case of incidents. And in my opinion, the industry is really necessary for our fire tactics. And my experience is they are quite willing to assist us. And assist is even in incorporating several features in their designs to make our lives more easy. So we have to deal in one direction to make and to prepare adequate incident management plans. But the other way around, we really should get into contact with industry so they know what our concerns is and they can assist in our concerns. Which makes it to my final slide. We are doing a brief study after safety aspects of the energy transition. So if you have sources or people you know who are involved in energy and safety aspects, please provide me the information and we will take care of getting into contact to see how we can learn from countries beyond the Netherlands regarding safety aspects of the energy transition.
Thank you, Niels. Well, ladies and gentlemen, all the things that Niels was telling is what's puzzling me in my job as a chief of the fire department in Rotterdam, but not only there, because as I told you, I'm also responsible for the overall view of risk management for all the fire departments in the Netherlands. And this is one of the, I think, good examples where we from risk management work closely together with the fire colleagues from incident management, because me and my colleague Esther Liebe from The Hague, we are responsible for the subject of the energy transition. And yesterday I learned we have to be more reflective about our own expertise and we need to find solutions with the industry together. So I think this was a perfect illustration of what we're looking for. So thank you very much. I can imagine that there are a lot of questions. We have 5 minutes, so I say we can do two or three questions. And I have a lovely assistant who is going to help me with the microphone. So I think that's better, just not to offend somebody. So Liebe, you, are there questions? There must be questions. Yeah, thank you. Can you please say your name?
Yes, Dietmar Kuhn, Luxembourg. Recently there had been a seminar in Brussels from the CTIF. And they just released a booklet on tactics involving emergencies with alternative driven vehicles. Is that to your knowledge?
Two of my colleagues actually were there.
Okay.
And we are in contact with also with Kurt Vollmacher, in order to see what are the guidelines that he produced with his colleagues, and how do they fit with, let's say, our Dutch environment. But that is making the transition to the Netherlands. But in the end, transportation is an international activity. So what Koot is promoting, and I really support that way of thinking, is that we should get rid of those national, let's say, guidelines and see where we can come to generic European guidelines. But we know, and we think it's a good way that now, together with Firefighting Netherlands, we have two persons in these CTIF working groups to get the knowledge to our country and to push our knowledge to the CTIF.
Okay, thank you very much.
Somebody else has a question? Becca.
Whoa.
Oh. Well, Liebe did a better job than I did, so I won't comment on it.
I have more a remark than a question, in the sense that there is a lot of politics happening in Brussels around the energy transition, and I believe that somehow you should be following that and giving some input to the European Commission, because what is happening is that you try sometimes to work out solutions post factum. And yes, that makes your job very difficult. So I would strongly advise that you should connect with the European Commission and follow the policy developments. And sorry, I forgot to tell my name. I'm Adriana Jalba from Flame Retardants Europe, and I live and work in Brussels. So I'm very aware of all this struggle with the policy trends and how they reflect in the reality, in fact.
I think it's a really good advice. Could we make use of you? Yeah, because
well, I'll give you my contact, and to the extent that I can help you.
Yes, because it is quite a simple sentence. Get in contact with you, because the policies around the energy transition are made in Europe and maybe in The Hague. But getting into in contact, even within the Netherlands, we had, I think it was summer this year, we had this plug-in session about the energy transition with the project manager from the safety aspects of the energy transition. It was quite difficult to even get within contact with a Dutch colleague, to influence the policy and the safety regarding the energy transition. But I think you're really right, and I think we as firefighting organizations in Europe should make a fist and knock on that door in Brussels. And I look at you, Ricardo, for your assistance as well.
Well, thank you for your remark, because I think it's very valuable to look into that. Especially as fire departments, we don't want to be the party who's always saying, oh, it's not possible because it's dangerous. Especially in this time that we want a cleaner environment and everybody wants to work on it. But we also want to do it on a safe way. And I totally agree that we have to do some more marketing about the fire department in Brussels. So Ricardo, René, you have a nice challenge here, I think, and also Niels. So Niels, thank you again. Ladies and gentlemen, can you please give Niels an applause again? Thank you.